Hello, friends. In this review, we'll talk about an interesting gadget, the Ulanzi TC001 Pixel Wi-Fi Clock, which is positioned as a device for YouTube bloggers, as it can display subscriber statistics. However, in reality, its capabilities are much more extensive thanks to the use of the popular ESP32 module and a screen with addressable LEDs. We'll start with the functionality of the standard firmware, which also has many interesting features, and I will show in detail all the actions needed to display YouTube statistics. If you find the topic interesting, I will work on a continuation and unconventional applications, including integration with Home Assistant. Before we begin, please like this video, it will help others interested in devices and technology find it, and subscribe to my channel if you haven't done so before. Model, Ulanzi TC001. Device type, smart pixel clock. Number of screen LEDs, 256. Interface, Wi-Fi 2.4 GHz. Power supply, built-in 4,400 mAh battery, USB-C. Battery life, about 5 hours. Dimensions, 200 by 70 by 32 millimeters. Weight, 283 grams. The device comes in a dense cardboard box with color printing. Everything is very beautiful and presentable, arriving sealed in plastic. The packaging is excellent, using shockproof holders, and the contents are held securely in place. The set includes the clock, a manual, and a USB-A to USB-C cable. The manual is in two languages, Chinese and English, made with quality and color. All the essential information is there. The cable fits standard USB-A to USB-C connectors. There is no power block, but any from an old phone or charging station will do. High power is not required. The front part of the device is the screen, measuring 20 by 7 centimeters. More precisely, it's not a screen, but a panel of addressable LEDs, 32 by 8, totaling 256 pieces. The case is white, though I think black would be interesting too. The LED panel is located behind a semi-transparent plastic cover, which has a protective film attached, not very neatly, as several dust particles got underneath, and in my case, removing the film was not easy because it exactly matches the size of the screen. It's hard to lift without scratching the plastic. On the top, there are three buttons. The outer ones are for scrolling through options, the central one is for entering the selected mode, and there's also an ambient light sensor. On the back, on the left, there are two holes for the speaker, at the bottom, a USB-C port for charging, to the left of which is the charging indicator, and to the right is a button to reset settings. An important point, the USB-C port is not only for power, it's a fully-fledged serial interface, similar to the standard Node MCU development board. This means you can reflash the ESP32 without soldering and even without holding down buttons on boot. On the bottom, there are two rubber anti-slip feet and brief instructions for setting up the Wi-Fi network. To turn on, you need to press and hold both the right and left buttons on the clock simultaneously. After that, the clock activates a Wi-Fi access point, displaying its name and IP address on the screen. Search for this network name in the list of available networks and connect to it. No username and password need to be entered. You will be automatically redirected to the device's web interface. If not, go to the address shown on the screen. Here, you need to select your network from the available ones, enter the password for it, and press the Save button. Wait a couple of minutes for the settings to be applied, and the clock will connect to your home network. By default, the clock will display the IP address assigned by your router, the current date, and time, and it will be accurate. The dashes under the time represent the days of the week, with Sunday being active, hence the last, seventh one is highlighted. In your browser, go to the clock's webpage using the IP address displayed on it. By default, the menu is in Chinese, but you can use the auto-translate feature or switch the menu to English by selecting the second option in the top drop-down menu and pressing the Save Settings button at the bottom. Now everything is clearer and more convenient. The next option is brightness control, where there are two modes, automatic, where brightness will adjust based on external lighting using the light sensor near the buttons, and manual. In manual mode, you can choose a level from 0 to 100%, where 0 means the screen is off and 100 means maximum brightness. Additionally, you can enable and set a time for night mode, for which a different brightness setting will apply. For comparison, 100% brightness. And this is 10%. Switching between screens can be done manually, only using the buttons on top, or automatically, where, in addition to the buttons, screens will change through a set time interval. The scrolling speed will only apply to values that do not fit on one screen and changes from 0, where scrolling is disabled, to 10, the maximum speed. Display of the IP address, scrolling speed, 1. And this is the maximum 10. Next are the time zone settings. In my case, automatic detection works correctly, but if necessary, you can specify it manually. Then, the time display format, with or without seconds. Then, the date display format, month first then the day or vice versa. The option to display the days of the week is 7 dashes under the time, the one corresponding to the current day of the week will be highlighted. And which day of the week to consider the first, Sunday or Monday. After all settings are applied, save the parameters and move to the next page. Here you can manage what exactly will be displayed on the clock. By default, time, date, and IP address are enabled. Let's see what's here. The weather option takes data from a Chinese site. For its operation, a city ID is needed. For this, go to the specified address, and in the search, look for your city. It may not be there, as this is a Chinese portal, but major cities can be found. For example, Kiev was found and even displayed a weather forecast, more or less similar to the actual one. Take the city ID from the link in the browser's address bar. At least, I don't know of any other way. If you know another method, please write in the comments. Insert it into the clock settings line and enable the weather display option. The weather screen appeared. Enter the mode by pressing the central button. Here a number of parameters are displayed: temperature, humidity, pressure, and so on. However, in my case, they are all zeros. I think this will only work for Chinese cities. The next four options are designed to display the number of subscribers on social networks. Three of them are Chinese, unknown to me, but how to connect YouTube, I will show in this video but a bit later. For now, let's look at simpler options, such as the screen for displaying scores. Select the desired screen using the outer buttons, then enter its mode with the central button. The score values change with the right or left button respectively. A double press decreases the value. Pressing the central button resets, holding it, exits the mode. The next two options are the chronograph and the Pomodoro mode. For those who don't know, the Pomodoro technique is a time management method to enhance work productivity. You work with maximum concentration for 25 minutes and then take a 5-minute break. Chronograph. Enter its mode with the central button. The same button starts and then stops the time counting. Holding the button resets the stopwatch and exits the mode. The next press re-enters the mode. The Pomodoro mode works on the same principle. Select the desired screen and enter its mode. Then start the countdown. The next options are the battery charge level indicator and the matrix. This is just a screensaver. This is how they look on the clock screen. Autrix is a project for pixel matrix displays, originally created for the ESP8266. Due to hardware limitations, it was necessary to run the Autrix host server on another computer, which would control the pixel matrix. The Otrix simulator in the TC001 firmware mimics the Otrix matrix and allows controlling the clock using the standard Otrix host. Despite the development halting in August 2022, the Otrix community still supports the infrastructure's operation, and there's a corresponding add-in for Home Assistant. Within this video, I won't cover this feature in detail, but I might do so in the future. The About button at the very bottom of the window displays a screen with information about the connection and firmware version, in my case, 1.7.3. There's also a menu for its update. Now, let's move to the option of retrieving the number of subscribers on YouTube, the most interesting option for owners of their own channels. Here, in the settings, you need to enter two values. The first is the channel ID, which is the easiest part, and the second is the API key, which is a bit more complicated, but I'll show you the entire process step by step. Channel ID, simply copy it from the browser's address bar and paste it into the settings field. As I said, this is the easiest part. To get the API key, we need to go to the official Google Developers portal. Make sure you are logged in with the account your channel is registered to. Here we need the Products tab, in which we need to select the YouTube item, located at the very bottom. We land on the next page. Here we need to click on the picture on the right or select the guide menu. Next, we need to go to the Google Developers console. Of course, this path can be somewhat shortened, but I decided to show all the stages in as much detail as possible. Here we need the Projects menu. We go into it, and here we choose to create a new project. Think of a name for it and press the Create button. Now in the console, all further actions are done within this project. If you have other projects, make sure that you have selected the correct one. Next, we need the Library tab. There are many different APIs here, but we are interested in very specific ones. Scroll down until you find the YouTube API section. There are three of them. Let's enable all. For this, one by one, click on each API and press the Enable button. After that, return to the library again and move on to the next API. Enable the second, and then the third. After that, we need the next tab, Credentials. Here we select the menu for creation, in which we choose the option, API key. Wait a bit while the key generation process takes place. Then a window appears with the key. This is what we need. Copy and paste it into the second field on the clock page. But there's something else we need to do here. Next to the created key, we see a warning icon. Although we've done everything correctly, the subscribers will not yet display on the clocks that use this key. Click on it and go into its settings. On the right, we see our key in text form, which can also be used for other projects. Scroll down. Here's the key restriction option. By default, they are not set, which causes the warning to appear. We need to choose the option, Restrict the key. After that, a drop-down list with APIs appears. Open it and mark the three YouTube APIs we just enabled. Make sure that the APIs we selected are displayed here and save the settings. In my case, they were applied instantly, but in principle, it could take a few minutes. The key now has restrictions, the warning icon is gone. As you can see, the process is not complicated, especially if you have a detailed instruction. Insert the API key into the YouTube setting. If you have so many subscribers that the number does not fit on the screen, you can choose which direction to scroll it. You can also specify the font color. By default, it is white. What the number format option does is not entirely clear. I did not see a difference when changing it. The number of subscribers is displayed but is rounded down to the nearest 100. If you have not yet subscribed to my channel, now is the perfect time to do so. We have explored the capabilities of the standard firmware of the clock, but it's important to understand that this is essentially a standard ESP32 module connected to a matrix of addressable LED size 32 by 8 dots. This opens up many customization options, and if you've already tried some of them, it would be very interesting to learn the details, write in the comments. That's all. I hope this video was useful and interesting to you. I would be grateful for your likes, as it helps its promotion on YouTube. If you don't want to miss new reviews and tutorials, subscribe to my channel. In the video description, you will find a link to the official Ulanzi store where these clocks were purchased, as well as links to my Telegram channel, now available in Ukrainian, Facebook page, and a group for discussing smart home topics. Thank you for your attention. Until next time, peace to everyone.